Hi guys, welcome back to CJ's Keto Kitchen. Tonight we're gonna go to the sea. We are going to make seafood cakes in two different ways, both salmon and crab. So come along with me and let's get started. So when I was growing up, one of my very favorite dishes that my grandmother would make was salmon patties. And she did it very basic and traditional. It was basically canned salmon, and I think she used Ritz crackers and an egg. But we just absolutely loved it, my sisters and I. She would usually serve it with macaroni and cheese. But tonight, we are gonna be having ours with broccoli. That's a little more keto friendly. But I have keto-ized these. Generally, binders in these type of cakes are panko breadcrumbs or saltine crackers or some kind of breadcrumb idea. And so I have made these ketogenic by using a keto-friendly breadcrumb. So it's a very fond food memory. And if you're from the Chesapeake Bay area or Maryland, the Atlantic coast, crab cakes and fish cakes are extremely popular. Sometimes in the South also, they're done in a Creole style. So hopefully this will bring back some fond food memories for you, like it has for me. And let's go ahead and get started. So we are going to start doing our salmon patties first. And so you're going to need a medium-sized bowl because we are going to mix up our mixture and then fry it. You're also going to need canned salmon. If you would like to make a larger batch, you can use two cans. But what is nice about canned salmon is it's almost always wild-caught and not farmed, because farmed salmon does not can well, so you can pretty much guarantee that you're going to get a fresh product. This is what it looks like when it comes out of the can. It's almost like an entire salmon without the head and the tail. So if you're squeamish about skin and things like that, you can peel it off. Some brands will come skinned. I happen to like it, and I also happen to like some of the bones in there. That was my favorite part when I was growing up. So, but it's personal preference. You could peel the skin off if you want. But so much of the nutrient density is within the entire fish. So I'm going to drain off this excess liquid, mash it up a little bit, and put it in our bowl. So this particular, you know, you hear people talk about nose to tail and it being very good for your body. This would be an example of nose to tail because you are basically eating the entire fish. So I'm just mashing that up in our bowl before I add our other ingredients. These are extremely versatile. You could make them in so many different ways. Okay, first thing I'm going to add is a little bit of celery. And this is just chopped celery. And I'm going to put in about half of that because we want to reserve some of our celery for our crab cakes. I have four chopped green onions here. It looks like a lot of onions, but it's really only four onions. And I'm just going to use, once again, about half of that. So about two chopped scallions. Likewise, this is one pepper. It is a half an orange pepper and a half a red pepper. And I just like the color variation. You could use green pepper if you preferred. You could use one color, yellow, whatever you'd like. So I'm gonna put in half of this. So it's only actually a half a pepper. The next thing I'm going to be putting in is about a tablespoon of fresh chopped dill. And I really think that fresh herbs, especially in this instance, really give a taste that you cannot necessarily get from powdered herbs. If you can only find powdered herbs, absolutely use them. But fresh herbs in this step are so nice, and they're not cost prohibitive, and they're found in most local grocery stores with the rest of the vegetables. Okay, so we now have our salmon and our vegetables in there, and I'm just going to give that a stir. And then we are going to start adding our binders because we want this to stick together to form into patties so that we can fry them up. Now, when my grandmother made these, she basically just used the canned salmon and Ritz crackers and an egg. So if you don't want the vegetables in there, you could absolutely just simplify it with your salmon and egg and your binder. But I happen to like the crunch and the freshness of the vegetables in this dish. For our binders, I have ground up pork rinds. So just plain
pork rinds, and I ground them up in my blender. If you have a food processor, a mini food processor, anything like that, if you don't have any of those things, you could put them in a baggie and bash them with a rolling pin. It just gives the fine texture of breadcrumbs or crackers. It's traditional for like saltines or that kind of thing in this type of recipe, but that's not keto. So I'm going to be using pork rinds instead. So I want about a cup of pork rinds. And that's just going to assist in our binding. I also want just about 2 tablespoons of almond flour, and this also assists in our binding. And then I'm also going to add just a couple of tablespoons of grated Parmesan cheese. It just gives it a nice flavor and richness. And it also assists in that breadcrumb texture that you would normally find in a dish like this. So I'm going to put 2 tablespoons. Okay, so we have our binders in there now. And I'm just going to redistribute it like I did with the salmon and the vegetables. And make sure everything is well combined, and then we are going to add our liquids. Okay, so we need 1 egg. I'm also going to add about 2 tablespoons of heavy whipping cream, and this just aids in the binding and gives it a bit of richness. And now we are going to add a bit of seasoning. I'm going to add just a couple of dashes of garlic powder, a little bit of black pepper, and just a little bit of Himalayan sea salt. And now I'm going to stir that all together. Sure that we get our egg really well incorporated. Okay, so now we can start forming these into little patties, and you can make these patties in whatever size you like. I generally try to make them a little smaller just because I like them, you know, about that big. And they cook up well and they cook up quickly. And you can have multiple ones. You could actually use these as appetizers or hors d'oeuvres for a party. They work really well for lunches, and in fact my family likes them cold, so it's up to you. But I'm going to take probably about a large serving tablespoon size and just form it into our little patty. And over here I have a skillet with avocado oil in it because we are going to fry these on both sides, and it usually takes about 3 to 4 minutes per side. So I'm just going to start placing them in the pan. And you have your pan on about medium, between medium and medium high. And as I said, if you wanted to make these into larger patties, you absolutely could, like the size of a hamburger patty. You would have to adjust your cooking time to accommodate that, of course, because they might take a little bit longer to cook or get brown. And it's nice because you can see the fresh dill in here. It's very pretty in all these colors. It makes a very pretty dish. And you kind of want to leave them alone. You don't want to mess with them too much once you put them in the pan on the one side so that they have the opportunity to form a crust. So I'm going to start flipping them now. And you can see they're nice and golden, which is what we're looking for on both sides. You could definitely make this mixture ahead of time if you wanted to, and then just assemble them and fry them. So kind of like a food prep idea, if that makes it easier for you too. Although the preparation didn't really take that long. Okay, I'm going to check these. That's not quite ready yet. The middle ones maybe though. Yes, they're good. So I'm going to remove them from the pan and put them on a paper towel lined plate, the ones that are completed. Generally, the ones in the middle cook more quickly. Now you could serve these with a variety of dipping sauces. Mustard and mayonnaise mixed together is very good, similar to an aioli. You could use cocktail sauce, but you just have to watch for carbs, make sure that it's low in sugar. You can serve them with tartar sauce, which is what I'm going to be doing. And I have found that the Beaver brand is the lowest in carbs. You could, of course, make your own if you wish. There are our salmon patties. So now it's time to start our crab cakes for our second part of our seafood cakes. We're also going to need a medium bowl for this step. I have canned crab that I have taken out of the can, drained, and put in a bowl with a paper towel to catch the excess moisture. I have three 6-ounce cans here, so it's a little bit over a pound of crab. If you prefer to use crab, sometimes there's fresh crab in the deli, and it's usually in larger flakes like that, but I'm going to be using this product. So I'm going to dump that into the bowl. So once again, we are going to add our vegetables. I'm going to add the celery that is reserved from our salmon patties. The rest of our onion, which was 4 green onions, but they chopped up very small. The remainder of our red and orange pepper. So there we have our vegetables, and I'm just going to give that a stir. Make sure everything is well incorporated. Okay, once again, we are going to add our binders to this. So I want a cup of our crushed pork rinds, about 2 tablespoons of almond flour, 2 tablespoons of Parmesan cheese, we want to put in our seasoning. So I'm going to add a couple of splashes of Worcestershire sauce, a couple of squirts of yellow mustard. You could use Dijon in here if you preferred, or spicy brown. And a couple of dashes of Old Bay seasoning. It's very traditional for crab cakes to have Old Bay in them. I'm also going to put a little bit of salt and a little bit of black pepper. That was the Old Bay that I just put in, and you can do that to taste. My particular package does not come out in a great amount, so I would say it's probably less than a teaspoon of Old Bay. I'm going to mix that around just to incorporate the mustard and the Worcestershire sauce. Now, for my wet ingredients in crab cakes, I'm going to be using about 1/2 cup of mayonnaise, which is very traditional in crab cakes, just a couple of splashes of heavy whipping cream, just like I did with the salmon patties for richness and binding, and also 1 egg. just about 2 tablespoons as before with the salmon patties. And then we are going to mix that all together. And as before with the salmon patties, with crab cakes, you can make them into tiny little bite-sized servings, especially if you were going to make them for appetizers, for a party, or something like that. Or you could choose to make them a focus of your meal and make them into a larger patty. So it's completely up to you. But I'm going to get my pan heated up again, and we are going to fry these up. I'm going to check the ones in the middle, and yep, they are done. Usually the ones in the middle will get done more quickly just because of the burner. They are all nicely golden, but still tender on the inside.
CJ.
Hi.
Welcome to dinner.
Yep.
Tonight we are having seafood cakes two ways, salmon and crab.
I think I know which one is which.
They look fairly similar when they're cooked.
Yeah. I'm pretty sure that's the crab.
Yeah, it's a bit lighter in color.
Right, didn't.
You can just pick it up with your hands.
It's good. That was a crab cake.
Mm-hmm.
It's good too. Crab cake is a different texture.
Mm-hmm.
A little flakier.
It's finer, yeah.
Mm-hmm. A little finer. But they're both good. I like them. I think people like these. Not sure. It's kind of a old time dish.
Yes.
I'm not sure, you know. I remember having salmon cakes when I was growing up.
Yes.
Some of them my mom made. And I don't think I had crab cakes until I became an adult.
They tend to be a bit regional. Chesapeake Bay area.
Well, I grew up on the East Coast, so.
Yeah.
But I still don't think I had crab cakes until I was an adult. But these are good too. They're a different flavor profile than the salmon. But they're both equally good. I chose to not put anything on them. I could have put, like you said, tartar sauce or
that's why I'm gonna have mine.
You know, cocktail sauce. Of course, you need to watch the carbs, but
but
I wanted to taste them with nothing on them, and they're good.
Could you taste the dill and the salmon?
I don't know. It tasted good.
Doesn't knock you down.
So I see it. It's pretty.
Yeah.
In fact, it's got a lot of crunch to this because of the vegetables. So it's good. And I remember eating these cold too.
Yep. I like them.
So I think people will like them. So for some people, it'll bring back some memories.
Good.
So thanks for making it, baby. Bye bye.
Bye bye. We hope that you enjoy the seafood cakes as much as we are going to. Please consider subscribing and hitting the notification bell because we would like you to not miss out on any of our content. We upload new recipes every Sunday, and we also have ketogenic conversations on Wednesdays. Sometimes that's food unboxings. Sometimes we talk about lifestyle things. Sometimes it's what we eat on keto, so we definitely don't want you to miss out on that either. Also, if you would like to join us on social media, we are on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, Pinterest. Also, all of our recipes, macros, other recipe ideas can always be found on our blog, and that is cjsketokitchen.com. And if you would like to head on over there, there's a wealth of information and also different types of recipes. And you can also print out most of our recipes. So we would like you to come back and see us again next time, and we'll see you then on CJ's Keto Kitchen.